Welcome to the Michigan Association of Secondary School Principals New and Improved podcast series featuring great discussions, insight, and resources on all things related to education and administration.
Welcome back to the MASSP podcast. Today we are talking student growth and evaluation laws with Colin Ripmaster. Colin is a former principal, works with MASSP. So Colin, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and then we'll dig into evaluations.
Yeah, I'm a former elementary teacher, middle school assistant principal, high school principal that now serve as the associate executive director at MASSP, overseeing all of our professional development, membership, and non-dues revenues, so essentially partnerships, those types of things.
Wonderful. Thank you for everything that you do for MASSP and for all of its members. We really appreciate it. So looking at student growth as part of the evaluation system, what, why, how? Let's just start with from the beginning. What does the law require?
Well, initially starting in 2010 and then amended in 2011 and most recently in 2015, districts were required to adopt and implement for all teachers and school administrators a rigorous, transparent, and fair performance evaluation system. So I haven't met anybody yet who doesn't think the expectations of the rubrics or frameworks that they're using aren't rigorous. The transparency piece means that both teachers and administrators know what they're going to be evaluated on, and the evidence that's used to evaluate them is clear and available and accessible to those who are being evaluated. Fair means that we're providing teachers and administrators what they need to improve their practice and achieve their goals. Currently, 75% of the evaluation is to be based on professional practice as measured by those district adopted performance rubrics and consideration of the 1248 factors, while the other 25% is based on student growth and assessment data, which will move to 40% beginning next year.
So why does the law state student growth and assessment data? What is the difference, if there is any, between student growth data and assessment data?
Student growth is defined as the change in student achievement between two or more points in time. Assessment data is a broader term that encompasses both quantitative and qualitative measures. The assessment data permits use of proficiency data, perception data, attendance and discipline data, or other measures of student performance, not just academic measures. In fact, in some districts, they use the assessment data as your ability to not only write goals, but to reflect on what that data tells you. So if a district uses student growth data from multiple measures in the evaluation of teachers, then they fulfilled the statutory requirements for student growth and assessment data. So if you pre and post test, that change in score is student growth data and fulfills both parts of the student growth and assessment. However, if a district elects to use other assessment data, like proficiency on TATE test or average scores on a benchmark assessment, then one or more other measures must be used that show a change in student performance from two or more points in time. In other words, proficiency is assessment data. It's not student growth data. And so you're permitted to use it, but you have to pair it with growth, whereas any growth data fulfills both the growth and assessment portion.
Great. Thank you for that. What are the required weightings of student growth measures for teachers and administrators beginning in 2018-19? You mentioned it's going to change. So what will that look like?
Yeah, so student growth must account for 40% of the annual evaluation. So increasing from 25 to 40%, reducing the impact of your professional practice rubric from 75 to 60%. For teachers of grades and content areas measured by state assessments, half of the student growth and assessment portion of the evaluation must be measured by the state assessment. Or another way to think about that is 20% of your overall evaluation must be based on student growth and assessment data from state data, while the other 20% can be based on any local or other determined measures by the district.
To clarify that, does this mean that districts must attribute state test scores to all teachers 3 to 11 in which MSTEP, PSAT, and or the SAT is administered?
That's a great question that many people didn't know the answer. The answer is no. For purposes of educator evaluation, the Department of Education has determined that only English language arts and math teachers in grades 4 through 8 must use state test data. However, a district may elect to use state test data with other grades as well as determine how to attribute that data.
What measures of student growth must be used for teachers of grades and subjects not tested by state assessments?
State law requires that multiple measures be used in determining student growth for the purposes of educator evaluation. For teachers of non-tested grades and subjects, so K-3 teachers and any high school teacher, and those 4th through 8th grade teachers that don't teach ELA and math, the portion of student growth component not measured by those could be anything the district elects or defines as a growth measure or alternative assessments that are rigorous and comparable across school districts. In other words, a local benchmark assessment that you administer. So for example, at the high school, it may be a pre and a post, a first to second, beginning of the year to a semester exam. It could be a unit that you target for improvement. And so you could pre-test at the beginning of the unit and post-test at the end of the unit as one of those measures that change that shows a change in performance. In addition, assessments like NWA, the PSAT, the SAT, iReady, and any of those assessments can be used as well, but it's a district's discretion and responsibility to actually define what those are. I was working with a district about a month ago, and one of the things that they were looking at is persuasive writing or argumentative writing. And so during this unit, they really hammered home. So they did a pre-write, and they used the 6+1 traits of rubrics to assess that first writing. They just hammered home on this writing of and the argument of writing piece. And then they used a second timed writing, and they measured the growth from that first one to the second on that 6+1 traits of writing. In the PE classroom, they are using the PACER test to look at endurance. So at the beginning of the unit, they had students do this assessment. Essentially, they're moving from one point to another with a beep that kind of paces them along that. And they see how many they can do in a time frame that's provided. And then at the end of the marking period, they did it again. So they're looking at the change in endurance based on that assessment. So there's lots of ways to measure growth. It doesn't have to be from a test, and it doesn't have to be for certain lengths of time. That's up to the district to define that and what's permitted in their district. As long as it shows change in performance from two or more points in time, it's permissible by state statute.
How can student growth based on state assessments be included in the annual year-end evaluation when that data will likely not be available prior to June 30th, which is the deadline for reporting educator evaluation effectiveness levels to the state?
Yeah, state data won't be available when schools and districts are finalizing their year-end evaluations. But let's keep in mind that the state requires you to use 3 years of data or whatever's available. So the use of state data in educator evaluation will be based on prior year's assessment. Given districts are required to use those 3 years of data, the district will need to determine the three-year window for using test data. For example, one district that I work with are planning to use the 2016, 2017, and 2018 student growth percentiles from the MSTEP for their 2019 evaluation. So they have 3 years of data. It just happens to be 4 years ago to 1 year ago that they're using to combine for that 2019 evaluation. And then the other local assessments going to take from 2017, 2018, 2019. So in doing that, they're using the three most recent years of test data based on each assessment. So essentially it's a 4 year window, but it's 3 years of test data for each of those assessments that are administered. Whereas another district that I work with is electing to use the 2017 and 2018 student growth percentiles from the state data for their 2019 evaluation and local test data for 2017, 18, and 19, which would be essentially 2 years of test data from state test and 3 years of test data from local data in within that three-year window. So depending on how your district defines their three-year window, is it by assessment or is it by calendar year, will determine how many years of test data will be available for use. And both, according to the MDE, would be permittable interpretations of statute.
Will the MDE provide districts with growth data based on state assessments? How will schools and districts be expected to utilize this data?
Great question. Yes, The state will provide you proficiency scores for your students and building, scale scores and student growth percentiles for individual students. And so currently that data is available for the last 2 years in data fileables in the secure wipe site. Although the mean SGP is the recommended data point to use, so SGP being the student growth percentile, districts have the choice of which metric to use. So if you wanted to use proficiency as part of the assessment data portion, you could do that. If you wanted to use change the scale scores or raw scores, you could do that. If you wanted to use the student growth percentile, those are all permissible in our local district decisions on how they're going to use that test data. The state is recommending, the Department of Education is recommending the use of the student growth percentile. However, the state does not have the means to connect individual student data to individual teachers. Consequently, districts will be responsible for tracking which student scores should be linked to individual teachers and assigning those scores to each teacher and aggregating those scores to determine a rating. In other words, the state will publish student level data, and it will be a district's responsibility to translate that data or apply that data to individual teachers.
So, Colin, if the state isn't going to do this work for us, what tools will be available to help manage all the data for teachers and administrators?
Well, MASSP has initiated conversations and collaborated with both the Michigan Department of Education, the Michigan Association of School Administrators, and the Michigan Data Hub to create tools to do this work. Initially, MDE has created an Excel spreadsheet under the leadership of Brian Lloyd that will allow districts to actually dump data files into a spreadsheet, an Excel spreadsheet that would actually calculate an SGP. However, this tool isn't automated, so just like any spreadsheet, you have to be able to put the data in there. And so if you have to do 20-some clicks in order to get a score for every teacher, it's quite labor-intensive, and it offers a lot of opportunities for error. And so it's a great tool if you are intentional about its use and accurate in making sure that we're putting that data together. The Michigan Data Hubs are working on a solution for districts that already are connected to the hub. And their hope is that by next year, they'll have that solution in place for districts to use. But in order for the data hub to work, districts actually have to sign up and be connected, and not only to access the data, but to take action with that. And currently, about 25% of the state is actually connected to the hub, with about 90%, based on their student information system and other things, able to do it. So they're working hard to get people connected. It only takes a couple of hours of a network person's time to get them connected. So it's well worth people's time, because what the data hub will be able to do is automate the linking of students to teachers, essentially what we call rostering, based on your student information system. So if you have Skyward or Infinite Campus or whatever, data hub will, Power Schools, the data hub will talk to that. And then in the meet, it's kind of like a conduit between your student information system and the state data, and it brings it together for reporting. So that would be a great thing for districts to get set up and to move forward with. So you'll at least have this year's data and next year's data in there, because they're not going back in time to do that.
And who should districts contact when they want to start setting that up? Who's the person to make that happen?
Yeah, so the Michigan Data Hub is centered right here at the same building that MASA, MASSP, and MSBOA and them are at, right here in Lansing. And it was originally started as part of that TRIG grant. So most districts' network administrators are aware of this, and it really is a phone call. And if you Google the My Data Hub, it will come up, and there is contact information there. We've been told it takes a maximum of 2 hours of time to link an entire district. So the 2 hours of one person's time in the district to save hundreds of hours for every administrator, I think, is well worth that investment moving forward. And then the third tool that's out there that just came out, in fact, the beta version was just tested in the last 2 weeks and is showing great promise, is created by one of the analytic tools that districts had the choice to use as part of a grant. And so in Michigan, there's really three data tools that are used. One is Unetrics, a second is Forecast 5, and a third is IDEX. IDEX is the most broadly used in Michigan, with approximately 299 school districts, 201 charters, and 16 ISDs in Michigan currently licensed with IDEX. IDEX was originally created to look at financials and be able to take that publicly reported data and compare it. But we approached them about their use of their analytic tools that are already connected to the hub, as well as already modeling data to say, could you create this student growth percentile calculator? Could you create an SLO tool that would be able to calculate gradings by teacher and building, which of course the building then would become the administrator's evaluation. So they've been working for the last 2 months diligently to make that happen. And I'm proud to report that as of yesterday, they were successful in creating this tool, and we've used it now with two different districts as pilot districts. And it's really impressive what they've been able to automate. So what might take 20 to 100 clicks in an Excel spreadsheet is really just a click of a button for IDEX in their work, and they can model the data and everything else, export that data for evaluation. So I think that's a real promising thing. I'm sure Forecast 5 and Unetrics would be interested in helping with that. We've had some preliminary conversation with Illuminate too, that some people use as a data warehouse to create that. And so I think they have some things underway too. But so there's some promising tools coming, but a lot of that's dependent on getting districts connected to the hub so that that data can be rostered. Yeah, it's really promising, considering that's one of the major pain points for many in the district.
Based on your experiences, what work still needs to be done for most schools?
There are three significant steps most schools need to take to better prepare for the 2018-19 school year as it relates to use of student growth and assessment data. The first is that many schools have assessments that are in practice. However, they really haven't inventoried those assessments. So it's tough to know from a district perspective, what are all the assessments we're administering kindergarten through 12th grade for every subject area and discipline? So we think one of the first steps that districts should do is invest the time in creating an assessment inventory that defines what those assessments are that are already administered at each grade level and subject area, determine which may be used for purpose of evaluating educator effectiveness for each grade level, and then address the gaps for those grades and subject areas where measures may be lacking. So we know in some of our elective areas, they're not off-the-shelf vendor-provided or locally developed assessments. So what are those pieces we can do? So I used the example of the PACER assessment in a PE classroom. So in that classroom, there are multiple assessments: is the PACER for endurance, the sit and reach for flexibility, the mile run walk for the speed and endurance, and then some power things for strength. In a music classroom, both for orchestra, choir, and band, what I've been seeing people using is adjusting the solo and ensemble rubrics. And so at the beginning of the year, the multiple measures is the rubric for solo is one measure, and the rubric for an ensemble is a second measure. And it, music teachers are using that to measure growth from one grade level to a next. In art, I see a lot of portfolios, and I've also been seeing more and more projects. So where a teacher may be working on like perspective drawings or pointillism or some type of aspect of art. And so they target that as one of their measures and use a rubric and student sample work in order to show how students are progressing within the curriculum. I think the important part is that the tools that are used are actually authentic, rigorous, and comparable to that discipline versus some contrived assessment just for the ease of that. The second piece is, I think for each of those assessments, it's important that the district determine the statistical model. So are we going to do student growth percentiles? Are we going to do student learning objectives? Are we going to do a simple growth model where we're just going to look at 2 points in time? And then what are the data points from those measures for each? Are we using the raw score, a percent, a scale score, some type of multiple measures, depending on the tool, get point out there. And then the third thing, and I said this earlier, was connecting to the data hub in order to automate the rostering, because we need one way or a way to roster student data and then be able to aggregate the results in order to calculate the student growth rating. So one, assessment inventory. Two, define the statistical model and the data points that are to be used for each of those measures. And then three, connect to the data hub as soon as possible to automate this process.
So looking ahead, forecasting the future, where will Michigan go from here in regard to evaluation practices?
Great question. I don't have a crystal ball. I've had lots of people speculate that this too shall pass, like many things in education, and it just becomes a merry-go-round. What we do know is the legislature has taken three different iterations of this law and continued to refine it. And the intention was to define what needs to happen and attempt to address compliance by requiring districts to post assurances on their website. What we know, though, is that we are at this crossroads. Some have adopted a fixed mindset that focuses on compliance and checking the box with little to no impact on professional practice, despite significant time and money spent on foundational training, observing, providing feedback, and writing reports. On the other hand, we have a great number of districts that really have adopted a growth mindset. They're not looking to the state to tell them what to do. They're really investing in the tools that they've adopted so that they can use supervision evaluation as a high leverage tool for growing professional practice and ultimately eliminating the achievement gaps that divide our nation's children along lines of race, class, language, and disability. So given the current climate of litigation, for those who are just checking the box or those who are fear or moved by some type of threat of lawsuit or tenure act, whether you're in that place or you're looking at this from how do we actually help support our teachers and administrators to be the best for our teachers, I think really what we need to do is pretty similar. First, we need to further invest in building the capacity of teachers and administrators to understand and then consistently demonstrate the standards of practice defined in your performance evaluation tool. That can be done through the professional development that you plan as part of your school improvement, providing mentoring support to teachers and administrators who may be struggling, providing coaching in how to do this work, and engaging people in clinicals around this work, whether it's action research or some type of way of actually learning together in our PLCs. A second thing I believe is important is identifying and implementing student growth measures that are actually appropriate for growth models. There are many assessments we do to progress monitor students' learning that weren't intended to benchmark the impact or the magnitude of a teacher's instruction on that learning. So things that are more formative in nature were tended for that progress monitoring so you can make those in-the-moment adjustments and adjust future lessons. Well, benchmark assessments and some of the standardized assessments that are out there were better used for the purposes of student growth. So although student growth doesn't have to be measured with a test, if you are using a test, it's important that whatever measure you use covers the lower and upper ranges of student performance that are they're not only vertically aligned and scaled to more accurately measure student achievement from year to year, but ultimately it's critical that they're aligned to state standards. So are the assessments we're using actually measuring what we're going to teach? Because as we know from computers, garbage in and we get garbage out. So as we move forward, it's critical that we do those assessment inventories, determine whether or not which assessments are actually aligned to the state standards in our district curriculum, cover those upper and lower ranges, and then are actually serve the purposes of measuring student growth and the impact of educators on student learning.
Now that we've talked about evaluations and what's coming and what's happening, what professional development is available through MASSP that would support our learning and our work?
As districts grapple with implementing statutory requirements for annual evaluation, that common pain point has been the use of student growth and assessment data. in response, MASSP has been facilitating student growth and assessment workshops, and most recently has collaborated with MASA to host a Student Growth Institute in Lansing on April 25, so just around the corner. This one-day institute was designed to engage teams of school leaders because it's critical that not only the building principals and the teacher leaders impacted of this, but also our superintendent and other central office decision makers are engaged in this conversation, as well as our data and network people who actually have to help to make this happen. So this institute was designed to bring those stakeholders together to get a common understanding of what the statute requires, review current practices, identify areas of strength and challenge within your local system, and then plan next steps to further address these requirements for the future. Given how popular this has become, we've opened that institute into a virtual learning opportunity as well. So if you're not able to make it to Lansing, you can register at a reduced rate to do it through a webinar. And so that's still available on our website. In addition, a variation of this institute can be made available locally or regionally for those unable to attend or to join us through the webinar to ensure decision makers clearly understand what those requirements are, which measures to use, and how to aggregate those measures for teachers and administrators and score those for purposes of educator effectiveness. In addition to this institute, MASSP has a full slate of learning opportunities that are geared towards teachers and administrators specific to curriculum, instruction, assessment, and leadership. These are those on-location, on-demand, online learning opportunities that are about practitioners supporting practitioners in doing this work. We invite you to learn more about these programs and services that are available online, on-demand, and on-location with our course guide that will be emailed out to members in the coming week. In closing, let me remind folks also that we have EdCon 18, June 25 to 27 at the Grand Traverse Resort. We're going to have breakout sessions that have to do with student growth and assessment data, as well as some of these tools that are available from IDEX and Illuminate. We'll have people there who are able to support with that. So we invite all of you to join us in Traverse City for this premier event in order to learn, network, and celebrate the successes of this school year and set the stage for 2018-19.
I'm thrilled to know that there's an online option. That's not a day I can get out of my building, so it's fantastic to know that we can still participate in this virtually. I'm also very excited to attend EdCon for the first time. We're bringing a small contingent from our district as well, so I can't wait to see and meet everyone else who will be there. I've heard amazing things, and I'm really excited to experience it for myself. So coming up, we've got the HR end of the year checklist. We've got the May checklist. We are wrapping up the end of the year. Be sure to subscribe on iTunes. Keep an eye out on the MASSP professional development that's available, and share this with your colleagues and on Twitter. So we look forward to seeing you next time. Thank you for listening.